I have two connections that have made me want to give this presentation. One is that I'm the daughter of Thomas Dale, who taught at Downer and then at Lawrence. But the other connection is one that I only found out about a year ago when Aaron Dix, who some of you heard the other day, was giving a tour. And we ended up here in the Teakwood room where we had not been able to come the year before because the building was being renovated. And she mentioned that this room was designed by Lockwood DeForest. So, of course, no one else had heard of Lockwood DeForest. And the only reason that I have heard of Lockwood DeForest is that I happen to know his grandson. So I kind of went, Lockwood DeForest? Oh, really? And he, I don't know him real well, but he's a very good lifelong friend of a very close friend of mine back in Santa Barbara. So, of course, I pricked up my ears at that and wanted to find more out about him, who he was, how Alice Chapman had known to get in touch with him to commission this room, and to explain a little bit about that to you. So I will be telling you, I think, eventually, of some history you already know about Miss Chapman and how the room came to Downer and then to Lawrence, and about this painting, which was an addition. And I hope that before that, I'll be telling you some things that you don't already know about who Lockwood DeForest was and how he figures into the history of American art and design, which admittedly is not my area of expertise, but never mind about that. So I hope that along the way I'll be mentioning some things that I find are fairly interesting connections. So you by now have probably gotten a little handout. You see, I used to be an English professor, so like my dad, well, not really like my dad, but so of course I had to make a handout, and it's also designed to help me get through this in less than 40 minutes. No, really, it'll be about 15 minutes. So who was Lockwood DeForest? He was a painter originally. He started out, he was a member of a very interesting family, which I won't really go on about for, because of time elements. Like Catherine Beecher that we heard about the other day, he had a very interesting family. He was kind of the dilettante, not exactly black sheep, but all his brothers were like lawyers. Even though one of them was head of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York for 17 years, he was the only one who really made a career to try and, you know, be his real career in the arts. And he started out as a painter, and I have some booklets here that you might like to look at later. I love his painting. It's a landscape painting. A lot of it was oil sketches from when he went on travels, and being of a fairly well-off family, he had lots of opportunity to travel. And one of the things that's interesting about him is that he was coached in landscape painting by a very famous American painter that if you've studied American art, you might have heard of, who is Frederick Edwin Church, who was very prominent in what's called the Hudson Valley School of Landscape Painting. And at one time, he was the most famous painter in all America and made lots of money, by the way, selling his painting, which isn't always the case, as you probably know. And he was related to, Lockwood DeForest was his great-nephew, although they were only 25 years apart. And so he would go and visit. They met up on some travels in Europe, and then DeForest went up to visit where Frederick Edwin Church lived. He built what is one of the most important artistic residences in the country. It's a place called Olana, and I have a whole little booklet from it because I just went there because they were having an exhibit there about how Lockwood DeForest and Frederick Edwin Church did sketching together and how much DeForest eventually contributed to this amazing residence that is on a bluff, overlooks the Hudson. It's this huge landscaped area that Frederick Edwin Church sort of did as his last artistic project. So I just happened to have visited there recently, so I have some material from there. Frederick Church was also very interested in Islamic, Egyptian, Oriental design, and so his house was quite extraordinary looking. I don't know whether to pass these around or if you want to look at them later. There's some pictures of what it looks like. It's rather extraordinary. And because DeForest went up there, he started getting interested in that kind of design and that kind of architecture. And eventually what he did was he formed a partnership with someone else you have probably heard of, Lewis Comfort Tiffany. You know, the stained glass guy, the guy that whose firm made these kind of made these very lamps. They were very good friends. Eventually, Tiffany married DeForest's cousin. I mean, they're all these people are all connected in all these really interesting ways. But they set up a business called DeForest and Tiffany Decorators, because they had decided that here was a nice business that you could, because this was called the Gilded Age. You know, this was a period where you had some really rich people who could afford to have a room like this in their house. And he needed to make some money. So what DeForest then did was he took, now here's a woman I want to learn more about, this is his wife, Meta Kemble from the DuPont family. And they went on their honeymoon. Can you imagine this? They went on their honeymoon to India because DeForest wanted to go and buy some stuff and bring it back and sell it through his partnership with Tiffany. This isn't the jewelry guy. This is the son of the jewelry guy, by the way. And so this lasted like 2 years. But man, what a honeymoon. You should read about, I mean, if you think it would be hard to go visit India now, imagine what it was like in 1881 or whatever it was. I mean, cockroaches, sliding down hills. I mean, they were intrepid travelers. This woman had a lot of guts to go with her husband on this trip. That's all I have to say about her. But anyway, DeForest became, and this is, I find this rather endearing of him, he became interested in trying to preserve and promote this amazing kind of artistry that goes into this kind of carving. This was all hand carved and hand sculpted out of teak. And it was done particularly a lot in, although it's called the East Indian Craft Revival, it's actually on the west side of India. If you look at a map of India, you know how India looks like over here on the left-hand side, on the west, that's where Bombay is. And the town, there's a town there called Ahmedabad that's down in like paragraph three here. And what DeForest then did was he set up a workshop for these native craftspeople where they were going to carve what he decided that he might be able to sell in America. Now, he was actually one of the few Americans that was involved in this. There were a lot of Brits because the British government at the time was kind of trying to show what good colonial masters they were, and they were promoting the native art. And so that's how, if you flip over the page for a moment, you'll find out how does John Lockwood Kipling have to do with this? Well, he lived in India. He was an artist and taught at an art school there that was designed by the British to help the Indian craftspeople. And he helped set up an exhibit. And at that exhibit, along came the curator of what was then the South Kensington Museum, later the Victorian Albert. And they had an Indian section, and he became the first customer of Lockwood DeForest's workshop and bought what was a tracery. Now, a tracery is, if you see these arches, that's kind of like what it is. I mean, it's this sort of lace-like effect And there's a picture in this book that there's another copy of out in the other room. This is a whole book about Lockwood Forest and has beautiful pictures, which I don't have really time to stop and show you, but we'll look at them later. So back to what he did. What they were designing, and now he didn't design them, right? Lockwood DeForest didn't design them. He ordered them. He went to India and he saw this kind of carving. Now, interestingly enough, where he saw it mainly was on the outside of buildings. Even though here it's all this lovely carving is inside, there it went outside and was kind of a way for the person to say what their social position was, right? I mean, they had to buy it too, right? But he was into the idea of adapting this for his clients. Now, if you go and see two of the buildings he lived in ever, there's one in Santa Barbara and there's one in New York, you will see architectural elements like that on the outside of the building, like they were in India. But he started designing, he started selling like pieces that people would then put in their house. And you see a lot of that if you ever have a chance to go to Olana, Frederick Edwin Church's house, because it's got some very similar elements to the Teakwood room. It's got cabinets like that. It's got a balustrade. It's got, you know, carving over the doorways. It's got beautiful carved teak frames for paintings. So then we get to the person that you know about already, Alice Greenwood Chapman. Now there's a woman, another woman I'd like to know more about because she just sounds like a super, super lady. I have a nice picture of her here, which I'll put back in this show and tell book I have. I think one of the things I like about her a lot is that she was so dedicated to Downer. She had gone to Milwaukee Female Cemetery Milwaukee Female College, sorry, later renamed Downer, as we heard recently. And she inherited an interest in art and music from her father. But here's my favorite quote about her was from Miss Briggs, one of the presidents of Downer. She felt that her life and her resources were a trust to be used for others, and she experienced the keenest enjoyment in exercising this trust. Boy, what a wonderful thing for someone to have said about you. She also clearly, to me, had excellent taste. When she ordered, first of all, she ordered the Teakwood room, as you know, and how did that come about? Well, she went to the World's Columbia, what's the name of this thing again? The World's Columbian Exposition in Chicago in 1893. And there she saw quite an amazing room that had been commissioned by Marshall Field and Company, who were now importing Oriental carpets, and they wanted a nice display room. So DeForest went back to India so he could oversee all of that, and he comes back and he installs it at the exposition, wins an award for it, and then along comes Miss Chapman. Now, somebody can help me later to figure out whether her father was there or not, because some say he was there, and some other people mention that he died in 1892, so, it's one of those things you come across when you're doing research, like, who do I believe here? But anyway, she was enchanted by it because, as you see even today, this is not that really dark stained teak. It's more of the original color. It's this lovely, warm color. It had an aroma, which I don't think it still has, but she just thought it was wonderful and ordered the room. And ordered and had DeForest designed how it would be. I'm sure she had a lot of input into it, but he designed it, and then he went back to India and he oversaw, made sure that they did all these things, and they brought the furniture. So a lot, not everything in this room was part of his work. All the teakwood came from his workshop. Some of the furniture. Now, most of these other objects of art, these statues and what are those things called? Urns? Vases? All of that actually was things that Miss Chapman collected on her various travels. But when she died, she, as you know, she gave $1 million to Downer and said that she wanted this beautiful library built, which I feel even more of a connection to because the architect of that library, by the way, happened to also have designed the libraries at Vassar, the alma mater of our new president, Mount Holyoke, my alma mater. So, of course, when I got to Mount Holyoke and I saw this library there that looked a lot like the Downer Library, it just never occurred to me that they didn't all look like that. So, and of course, she designed rooms. She wanted it designed so there was room for the Oak Room and for the Teakwood Room, and that they would be installed there after she died. So I think you know that part, you probably know all about already. And some of you will remember Emily Groom, who we heard about a little bit the other day. She made some tracery tiles that are in the ceiling. These are stenciled, which we think, stenciled, aren't they stenciled? Well, that's the way, there's a whole lot of stuff at Olana that was done through stencil. And she took the design pattern, she took the inspiration for the design pattern from some of the carving on the tables and stuff that, and the cabinet fronts that you'll see, and made these medallions for in the ceiling. Okay, so who else do I want to mention? Oh, yes, I want to make sure that we talk about this painting, and somebody's going to tell us a little bit more, some plant I have in the audience here. This is not the original painting that was here in Miss Chapman's house. There's a picture of the original room in this book. Maybe I should just pass this around. Anybody wants to look at it. You will see, well, maybe I took it out. What did I do with it? No, it's on the back of Miss Chapman. How appropriate. And you'll see that originally the picture that was over the fireplace was of a Wisconsin landscape. And so someone else is going to tell you the story about someone who came and saw that and decided there might be a better picture. And so that's this one, which is of the Hindu goddess of learning, knowledge, music, and art, which is very appropriate because, of course, that's what Miss Chapman used the room for and what Downerites used it for. Then before I ask for your input, I want to show you on the back side of your handout there, and the sort of like the last two-thirds of the page, I just listed some of the other places in the country where you can see work by Lockwood DeForest. There's a room that was a library of Andrew Carnegie that's in the Smithsonian's Cooper Hewitt National Design Museum, which is in New York. And I was very disappointed because I was just out to the East Coast and it turned out I couldn't go because guess what? They're refurbishing the room. They're going to have a special exhibit this fall highlighting this library and the furnishings that were done by Lockwood DeForest. Then there's the Bronfman Center for Jewish Life, part of NYU, that used to be his home, and you can see some of these architectural elements on the outside of it. Then the other person I want to mention, since we're talking about founders of women's colleges or presidents, ex-president, former presidents of women's college, was a woman who was the president of Bryn Mawr. She was very good with friends with this other lady who had lots of money, Mary Garrett of Baltimore, who just happened to be a friend of Lockwood DeForest's sister. You see how all these people have all these interesting connections. And they brought... they brought some work that he'd done for Mary Garrett to Bryn Mawr, and then he designed their library. So I'm very, or he designed the interior decoration. I don't think he did the architectural plans, but he did a lot of beautiful work there, which I haven't seen yet. But someday I will. And then at the bottom of the page, I put this in because this summer there's all this activity going on. There are these exhibits going on. I have two out of the four, specialty art magazines out this summer that have particular, these both have information about the exhibit that I just saw at Olana. I don't know what the other two are because they haven't been released to the newsstands yet. Or maybe one was yesterday, but I didn't have time to go to Barnes & Noble and find out. So that's down at the bottom of the page there. So finally, what I want to ask your information about, specifically, I want to ask if you have any questions, I'll try to answer them. But the other thing I'm really interested in finding out is some of you were at, specifically at Downer, because this is a little bit longer ago in history, and you know that there were some amazing people who came to the Downer campus. And I'm sure that most of them, even if they didn't give their lecture in the Teakwood Room, they came to the Teakwood Room for coffee or tea or whatever it was that you served. And one of them, and when I've been looking through the archival things, I'm leafing through these old alumni books, looking for references to the Teakwood Room, they don't necessarily say that. They say so-and-so came to campus, Eleanor Roosevelt in 1955. Did she come in the Teakwood Room? We have a picture here. Aaron gave me the picture. What did I do with it now? Oh, shoot. I knew I was going to misplace something. No, here it is. So somebody doesn't look like the Teakwood Room to me. It looks like the Oak Room. But I can't imagine that Eleanor Roosevelt came to campus and didn't come into the Teakwood Room.